So, Lee, can you, in a few words, describe my character and my role in the story?
Golo is a simple person, and so he finds Melisande very hard to understand. He just wants to meet a nice girl. maybe.
And there she is.
And there she is, and you're beautiful, and there must be some spark. There has to be something in the midst of everything that Golo sees, and there's got to be some love somewhere, otherwise he just wouldn't care.
No.
So there's a beautiful woman who is obviously very lovable.
Do you find her mysterious from the start, you think?
I think that's the main, one of the main things about her which drives the men mad is the mystery and the elusiveness of her. The fact that you can't get...
That's what I feel.
Yeah. I think for all three, the male bigger characters, that is the big draw, is the fact that she's mysterious and elusive. And for different reasons, we want to know her better. Belias is infatuated with her. Golo is, it's sort of, he wants to...
Almost like an obsession.
To have her anymore. And Arkel is his own reason. But I think you're right, the mystery and the elusiveness of her is the driving force behind them, the male character's obsession with her.
Yeah. Okay, who's next?
Oh! This opera has a particularly symbolist libretto. A total refusal of realism. How does that translate into the singing? Answers on a postcard, please, to P.O. Box, Geneva Opera House. You can tweet as well.
I think it's. I mean, Debussy wanted it to be like a play, very natural in the way that it's sung. And I think the fact that there's so much symbolism in it, which makes it vague, but it's still. I think it's almost more effective just to play it natural, to do it natural, to sing it in a natural way and sincerely, and not try and sing it in a vague way, but just to. And the vagueness is there between the characters and the words anyway. That you don't need to sing it in a vague way.
Make it if you make it. If you stay true to the music and also the text is so important here.
Yeah.
I'd say the symbolism is only for the audience.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, the characters are more involved in day-to-day stuff, you know.
Yeah.
Light the fire and Golo will come back, as opposed to the symbolism of fire and the symbolism of this, that, and the other, and walking in a forest. He's going hunting in a forest. Now, the forest may then symbol other things, but that's not for Golo to go, Freudian nightmare.
Yeah.
Nice. Abandonment issues. you know.
No, but that's the thing with mystery. Huh?
We
don't want to explain too much to the audience. At least for me, when I play a character like this, I want people to feel differently. Like who am I? Our relationships? It wouldn't be fun if it was okay. This is what you are supposed to feel, and this is
it's not symbolic if you explain it.
Yeah. It's not.
Yeah. Then it becomes an emoji.
It's a little bit like comedy.
This is a good quote.
In this production, plastic arts, choreography, and video meet Debussy's opera. What impressed you the most?
I like all of it.
Yeah.
But I that's the facile thing. But to me, you know, opera is Gesamtkunstwerk in that it brings everything together. And this is bringing even more than usual, because you have dancing as an extra element all the way through. It's not just sort of a sort of little annex with a ballet to be diverting for 20 minutes.
Yeah.
It's
amazing that they are kind of controlling our feelings or they are supporting.
It's an emotor. They express emotions which we don't necessarily express directly. The choreography fills in and they
make it stronger.
Yeah.
And for me, it's the first time I've been doing this with dancers, and I think it's really fascinating to work with dancers.
I'm an old lag. Been there, seen it.
I haven't. I like to be carried around.
Yeah, it's right for you.
Like in the end scene, this was the most amazing thing that they carry you. Carry me and I'm flying. It's like Rose in Titanic.
Okay. Ask a question.
So, Jacques, what do you like most about this music? And can you describe Debussy's music in a few words for someone who doesn't know it?
I'll answer the second question first. Monet painting. I think it's extremely clear, but it's a beautiful picture, but it's sort of, you can't quite put your get a hold of the picture in some ways, and I think it is impressionistic, so it is that same era, and I think it's exactly that. It's a beautiful picture, but the lines are slightly faded, and I think that's the remarkable thing about the music.
Well said.
And I love the fragility of the music. Each character has extremely fragile music. Nobody is 100%. Even Arkell, at moments, the music makes a singer fragile.
Yeah.
And I think that adds so much to the whole dynamic of the pieces. Is that you are forced in a way to be fragile through how the music is written, which sort of opens up the underlying emotions within the piece and the characters.
I have to say, it's actually one of my favorite operas. Yeah. I find it so beautiful. And I spent so much time learning it. Mm. I thought I would never learn it.
Yeah.
Because it's really complicated. Complex.
Yeah.
If you had to convince someone who doesn't know opera in general to come and see this production, what would you say?
Pretty Norwegian girl being carried by 8 naked men.
that's a draw.
There. So, yeah, I would say the same, actually. No.
Sex and death. What every good opera is about.
No, but I think it's a beautiful experience to watch this and to listen to this. It's a mystery of an opera, and it's really interesting to hear this music and see this beautiful staging and with dancers, great dancing. It's a lot of elements, I think, will attract also a younger audience, no? I would think so.
Yeah, and I mean, it's a coming together of some sort of world-leading people in their fields with Larbi and Damian. I mean, they're sort of, you know, world-class, world-famous choreographers. And the design of
Marina Abramović.
And then, you know, the music of Debussy, which is,
it's quite extraordinary, actually.
Yeah. But it's a rare occasion to see sort of those forces together. So it's a...
Yeah, and I mean, to me, it's quite cool because I've been speaking to a lot of... like young dancers and art students, and they are so intrigued by this. So that's quite. It can open up for a new audience, and
And just the music. There's nothing else like it in the operatic repertoire. It's sort of Pelléas and Mélisandre stands alone. There's no other opera which is similar to it or like it. It is very unique.
Yeah.
It's not like any of the Mozarts, where, not that if you've seen one, you've seen them all by any stretch of the imagination, but you can sort of recognize Mozart operas, you can recognize Wagner and things, but Pelléas and Mélisandre is unique. There's nothing else like it. Right. So this is a special time. Can you explain how this pandemic has affected your work?
Poof.
Although, to be honest, we don't know.
No, and that's... But it's also exciting, huh?
Perhaps that's the answer. We don't know how it's going to go.
No.
We don't know how it's going to go. So there may be some streaming. It might be live. It might be recorded.
Might there be maybe, audience?
Yes, there might be some audience members somewhere.
Yeah.
Sat somewhere.
Hopefully. It would be amazing, but...
And the orchestra is going to be spread out, the whole sort of bottom seating area, it will be orchestra. So if there are any audience members, they'll be higher up. So the conductor will be very far, which will be quite a challenge to get everything already quite complicated music together with the conductor miles away.
And balanced.
Yeah. Yeah. With the acoustic. Yeah, yeah.
So,
yeah.
It's an evolving thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know,
but we do what we can, huh? Yeah. We get tested like every week, and I'm not visiting anyone. It's a strange situation, huh? We go to work, we go home to the apartment, and we're not seeing anyone else.
Thank God for the internet.
Yeah. Thank God for Netflix and
FaceTime.
True.